everybody, and welcome to you from the family of Betty. I'm Neil Bowdler, Assistant Minister of this church, and I've known Betty for over 30 years, and I have the privilege of leading us through her memorial Thanksgiving service today. We have come together to remember before God the life of Elizabeth Betty French, to give thanks for all she has meant to us, to commend her to the keeping of God her Creator, and to comfort those who mourn with our sympathy and with our love, in the hope we share through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have gone for a fairly traditional flavoured service today, as we think that's what Betty would have liked. So one of the things that Mary has asked me to remind you is that although masks are encouraged, they're not compulsory, even under a red traffic light. But if you prefer to wear it, that is fine. If you prefer not to, you may wish to take it off. Although we are encouraged to wear them when we sing. So our first hymn, which is a good Welsh one for Betty, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. Childhood living with her elder sister Dora and younger brother Edward. Life changed dramatically in February 1941. To avoid the bomb raids of World War II, Betty was living in a small Welsh village called Rosilli, with her mother and two siblings. Tragically, a bomb made a direct hit on the family home in Swansea, and the blast instantly killed her father. The remaining family stayed on in Rosilli, a beautiful place by the sea on the Gower Peninsula in South Wales. The only drawback for Betty was a long two-way commute between Rosilli and Swansea to attend school. Growing up, Betty recalled the fun she had on the beach, especially during summer holidays. At Rosilli Bay and Fall Bay, With a big gang of friends, she went canoeing, swimming, and fishing off the rocks. Betty's mother was a very good hockey player who represented and captained the Welsh women's team. So it's no surprise that Betty also played hockey along with netball and tennis. But it was hockey she most enjoyed because she loved running and passing the ball. She also won prizes in athletics, passing her sporting genes on to all her four children. Betty had no idea what she wanted to be when she was growing up. She was too busy enjoying life in the present. When she finally left school, she thought she'd like to teach young children. She applied and got a job as a teacher's aide in a small school. After 2 years, she went to Teachers Training College at St Mary's College in Bangor, North Wales, where she attended from 1947 to 1949. It was here at a college dance on May the 26th, 1949, that Betty's best college friend, Lala, introduced her to her future husband, John French, who was a student at the nearby Bangor University. Betty said they danced the first dance and then every dance after that. This led to a first date, where they went to see a film together, then on to a dance at a student haunt known as Jimmy's. They saw each other 11 times that college term, and then not again until April 1950, when Betty spent 5 days in Bangor with John, who asked her to marry him. They married in December 1953, and the following July took their delayed honeymoon climbing mountains with ice axes in Switzerland and France for over a month. Before Betty and John had children, they walked and climbed all over Scotland and around the Gower Peninsula. Betty had a job teaching in a small primary school on the outskirts of Bristol, and John taught in a secondary school in Bath, 9 miles away. In August 1956, Betty and John bought and moved into their first house together in Bath. Betty gave up teaching, and her first son, Peter, was born the following year. David followed in 1960, Michael in 1962, and Mary in 1964. John eventually decided the family should move to New Zealand, where there would be better opportunities for everyone. After much discussion, Betty agreed, and the family left the UK on a ship called the Himalaya in December 1966. The journey took the family through the Suez Canal, stopping at various places on the way, including Cairo, Colombo, and Sydney, before arriving in Auckland. The family eventually reached their destination of Motueka on January the 27th, 1967, almost the anniversary. Moving to a new country was a big change for Betty, as she had left behind all her family and friends. However, the French family soon became a part of their new community. Betty's first 10 years in Motueka included a full life spent with her husband and children, exploring all the beaches, lakes, rivers, mountains, bushwalks that the Nelson region has to offer, along with the many activities and sports that all her children were involved in. Cubs to scouts, brownies to girl guides, rugby, football, netball, squash, basketball, swimming and tramping, to name a few. Sounds like more than a few. Her husband's main interest was in athletics, so every Monday evening in the summer, the family used to go to Mākua, where the children all competed with much success. When Betty's husband John became ill with cancer in 1976, Ruby and Ray Eberhardt kindly stepped in and lovingly cared for the three youngest children, who lived with them in their house in Kina for several months. Sadly, John died of cancer later that year. All the family were shocked at how quickly it had happened. Betty then asked each of her children individually if they wanted to return to live in the UK. They all said no. So Betty stayed and continued her long life in Motueka. A close friend from this church, Freda Gerslov, kindly gave Betty a job working in the Gerslov's family carnation flower business. There are many other people that also looked out for Betty in this manner, by encouraging and convincing her to join so many groups and activities, especially after her children had all left home. Betty was a regular churchgoer here at St. Thomas's Anglican Church for over 50 years. She was involved with the weekly cleaning of the church, attending the ladies' evening and afternoon church meetings, handing out the prayer and hymn books, and of course attending church every week, year in and year out. This continued until her latter years, and she found it too difficult to get to church. Betty joined the Rewaka Croquet Club in the late 1980s and played three times a week for over 30 years. Betty was very grateful for the amazing friendships forged at the club, which continued after she retired from playing at age 91, when she was thrilled to be awarded life membership of the club. Betty also belonged to and was an active member of the Motueka Ladies Progress Club. She regularly rode her bike well into her 80s as far as Lower Motere, end of Queen Victoria Street, to hand deliver the newsletters. In March 2006, she was awarded a life membership in recognition of her dedication and services to Progress and the community. Betty loved the outdoors all her life and could be seen in Motueka most days, either walking her dog Job, as she did for 12 years, or cycling to the Motueka beach, port, and around the inlet. As time caught up with her, she stayed closer to home, but enjoyed pushing her walker to Dex Reserve to watch the children play. Betty's first grandchild, Ben, was born in July 1984. She was lucky that Michael has lived near her most of his life, so she had frequent opportunity to spend time with his other four children too, Jemima, Isaac, Asher and Thomas. Once David and Monique moved back to the Motueka area, she got to know their sons, Anton and Abel, and loved to see all her grandchildren whenever she could. In the past few years, Betty became a great-grandmother of three great-granddaughters called Frankie, Lexi and Evelyn. In 2016, Betty filled out a book which asked questions about all aspects of her life, including, "Mum, how do you want future generations of your family to remember you?" She wrote, "I would like to be remembered by future generations of my family for riding my bike for almost all of my entire life. When teaching in Bristol for 6 years, I rode my bike to and from the school in all weather. I only had to stop riding when having my family, and then it was push and prams time. When I came to New Zealand, I rode my bike daily, and I still am today." And that's 5 years ago. She went on, "I would also like to be remembered by my cakes, coffee and banana, for playing croquet three times a week, and also becoming a bookworm, trying to complete cryptic crosswords in the listener, and for keeping a diary for the best part of my whole life. The only thing I don't want to be remembered by is my boring meals, which I served up to my family. They knew what day of the week it was by what they had for dinner." Betty loved her life in Motueka and said she had been forever grateful to her husband for bringing the family to New Zealand, as she believed he chose the best place in the country to live. You could argue that point, but never with Betty. She loved Motueka and the life she had here. Thank you all very much on behalf of the family for coming today and sharing some memories of Betty's long life. And now I think we've got a date to cover in.
Hi there, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Dave Burgess. I'm married to Mary, Betty's daughter, so she's my mother-in-law. Two things are going to happen while I'm standing up here. First of all, I'm going to read out a few words that Mary wanted me to read out on her behalf. And then I'll just add a few of my sort of thoughts as well at the end. So for this part, just imagine that I'm Mary with a deep voice and a moustache. It's going to be in the first person. When I wrote Mum's eulogy that Neil read earlier, I realised I'd written an account on what she did chronologically in her lifetime. Now I would like to share some thoughts and feelings as what she meant to me as my mother. I've always felt lucky that she was my mother because of her nature. She was a very kind, patient and understanding woman. She rarely raised her voice in anger, even when she would be justified in doing so, particularly when I would come home late as a teenager. Although Mum was more of a listener than a talker, I've always valued her opinions. Whenever I shared my plans and ideas with her, she was so supportive of me and would always look for the positive side of an issue. Our world has changed so much in the past 20 years or so with the introduction of the internet, social media, and with many aspects of our lives reliant on computers. Mum found that a challenge. On top of that are the many social and cultural changes that makes the 2020s such a different place for a person born in the 1920s to live. However, with a bit of time, my mother eventually accepted these changes with grace and carried on. I've always admired her ability to be non-judgmental. She accepted all people as she found them, even though they may have been quite different to the way she was. I'm very glad that we had a close relationship with each other. That endured for nearly 40 years of weekly letters and then daily phone calls over the past couple of years, along with many visits to Motueka to see her. I have many lovely memories to cherish. Their memories have been added to my memories and live on in me. On top of those words there, I'd like to add a few as well from myself. So this is me talking now, not Mary. I first met Betty in 1998 and wasn't quite sure what to make of her, but some things immediately stood out. She loved to have a laugh, she was an observer of life, and she was content with what her life had delivered. Betty loved living in Motueka, as Neil was just saying. She often called it the best town in New Zealand. She wouldn't hear a word said against it. Mary and I visited Motueka many times over the years, while Betty also came to stay with us in Wellington on quite a number of occasions. Mary used to take her out on long walks, and I mean long walks sometimes, 2 hours or more, to show her around. She liked those walks a lot. It was a lovely way for mother and daughter to spend time together. Betty was never much of a drinker, but on one occasion we took her out to a Welsh restaurant. A couple of glasses of wine later, and she was singing at the top of her voice to tunes being belted out by a pianist. Her Welsh singing genes shone through. Her sense of humour was broad. We used to own a DVD of the surreal 1970 TV show The Goodies. We showed her the first episode, which featured a giant mutant cat terrorising the neighbourhood. I've never heard someone laugh so much. We ended up watching the other 3 episodes straight afterwards, which she also laughed all the way through. And I must also comment on the letter writing Mary referred to, or Neil referred to earlier. Every week, Mary would be impatiently waiting for her mum's letter to arrive. Once it had arrived, I'd tell Mary that she didn't need to read me the whole thing, just the highlights. This usually meant Mary read me the whole thing. It became something we did, and it certainly kept me well informed about Betty's life. Weekly phone calls between Betty and Mary were based around the listener's cryptic crossword, which effectively Mary was teaching Betty how to do. About 10 years ago, Mary encouraged Betty to start reading books again, and Betty took to this like a fish to water, reading more than 100 books a year. She became a regular at the Motueka Library and kept a list of the books she read. During the latter stages of Betty's life, when her memory and physical health were declining, Mary took to daily phone calls, which rapidly became multiple daily calls. Mary used to suggest what TV programs Betty may enjoy and got her to write down the times and channels. She checked in to make sure she was eating properly. We even talked her through resetting her skybox on a few occasions. Sometimes that worked, other times we had to call on the cavalry in the form of Mary's brother Mike, who would drive over to sort out the situation. Mary's devotion to her mum was something to see, and it was obvious that Betty cherished the attention. In fact, and as Neil alluded to, at Mary's request a few years back, Betty filled out a book about her life, in which she said one of her wishes was to see more of Mary. I'm glad to have been part of Betty's life, and like a lot of her friends and family here today, I miss her calm presence. Anyway, thanks for listening, and I look forward to chatting with you all over a cup of tea after the service.
Well, then I'll ask Betty's good friend Frieda to come up and speak.
Much of what I've thought to say has already been covered by the other speakers, but just a few personal anecdotes. I came to Motueka in the early 1970s, and obviously Betty had been here for a few years then. We first met at St. Thomas's, where she was a regular attendee at the morning service for more than 40 years, and a member of the Anglican Women's Group, the AAW. Here she had a number of good friends, including Rachel Budge, Anne Blair, and especially Nesta Bloys, another Welsh woman. Every year, the AAW would put on an afternoon's entertainment for the old folk, and we would sing, recite, serve tea, and Betty and Nesta would do a Welsh skit, complete with tall black hats, cloaks, and sing-song Welsh voices, and everybody loved it. And we all laughed heartily, including Betty and Nesta. Betty loved to join in and help at the church fair, and sang in the choir for special services, such as Christmas carols. She had a good voice and knew all the old songs and hymns. After John died, Betty came to work with me in our flower business, and we spent many mornings working together in the glass houses and shed. And of course, we talked. We also sang. We often talked about our childhoods and families. And I probably knew more about the goings-on in the French household through those years than most people in Motueka. I'm not sure how long Betty worked for together, but I believe it was about 10 years. She would know because she would put it in her daily diary. Later, we moved our business out of Motueka, and Betty took up new interests, or more interests, particularly cycling, croquet, and progress. I didn't see so much of her, but we always enjoyed a chat when we met. Often, on the roadside, she'd get off her bicycle, and we'd have a chat. She also came to my daughter's wedding, and talking about the drinking, she had an unaccustomed couple of glasses of wine at the wedding, and you should have seen her. She and Jess McCarty did a little dance together as they went out. Very funny, yeah. In later years, she enjoyed a visit, a drive to the beach, an ice cream, and those conversations about the past. She loved reminiscing and laughed heartily at the memories. Betty lived her life to her own tune and enjoyed her family and her home and the countryside to the full in her own way. A good friend always. Rest in peace, Betty.
And now we have Alison from the croquet.
Hello, I'm Alison from the Walker Croquet Club, and I'm delighted to say a few words about Betty. And I was looking at this little book and it said, some people come into our lives and they quickly go. Others stay for a while and leave footprints on our hearts and we are never the same. Betty was one of those people I will always remember, respect and admire. She started playing croquet in the late 1980s under the very strict guidance of a stern, no-nonsense, retired Scottish surgeon by the name of Alistair Taylor. This did not bother the stoic little Welsh woman, who listened and took his advice on board and became a very good croquet player. Betty was made a life member of the club in 1919, and I always enjoyed a game with her, whether it was against or with her in doubles. Now, competition became very fierce if she was playing against her good friend Keith. Yes, it sort of involved a love-hate relationship on the croquet lawn, but they were the most loyal people and loyal friends you could wish to meet. And they played Rummy Cub every week when Betty stopped biking or in her Triumph car coming to croquet in the Triumph. Keith would bring her along all the time. She had a very good sense of humour, loved a joke, was very frugal, never said a harsh word about anybody. And once, Keith, you got one of those looks. You suggested Betty should go to a doctor. She was. What? She said, I've never had a doctor. She said, who needs a doctor? Even in her late 80s. And then Keith, a few months later, suggested a medical alert. Well, end of story, no, no, no. But eventually, she was tricked into one by that naughty Keith. And I'll never forget the day at croquet when Keith told her he was selling up and going to Abbeyfield. Well, you got more than one of Betty's looks. She said, what do you want to be going there for, Keith? You're too lazy. You can be doing your own stuff at home. And he tried many a time to suggest Betty go to Abbeyfield, but never, 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 never. I think that bike riding was her favourite thing to do, delivering the newsletters. And then eventually when Betty couldn't ride the bike, I think he bought her a mobile scooter. But that wasn't going to happen. Betty did not like that scooter. And the other thing that always amazed us was she mowed the lawns in her back, at the back of her house, and they were about as big as a rugby field. But she never, ever stopped. She loved to mow those lawns. Betty, we really miss you at the Croquet Club, and I just wish that you will rest in peace. You are a very good and loyal croquet player. Thank you.
Is there anybody else that would like to say something? All right. Well, we're going to have our first reading, which I believe Mike's going to come.
My name's Sandy. I knew Betty a long time, but as she slowly declined, and when she stopped riding her bike, I kept checking on her whenever I could. And I did the recycling every fortnight. So, and when she went into Woodlands, I did the recycling for the last time. But I do miss you, Betty. You better haunt me at some stage because I need the laughter.
This first reading is coming from Corinthians, chapter 13, 4 to 8, A and 11 and 13. Love is patient, love is kind, and envies no one. Love is never boastful, nor conceited, nor rude, never selfish, not quick to take offence. Love keeps no score of wrongs, does not gloat over another man's sins, but delights in the truth. There is nothing love cannot face. There is no limit to its faith, its hope, and its endurance. Love will never come to an end. When I was a child, my speech, my outlook, and my thoughts were childish. When I grew up, I had finished with childish things. Now we see only puzzling reflections in a mirror, but then we shall see face to face. My knowledge is now partial, then it will be whole like God's knowledge of me. In a word, there are three things that last forever: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of them all is love. I think it's quite apt for Mum that that reading was, as people have said, she never said a bad word about anyone. Slow to anger, real good time.
Thank you. Well, we've all heard these words about Betty and I think anything I would say about her, having known her, would be the same as many people have said, so I'm not going to say anything too much about her, other than I think her life was a witness and light to those around her. Her family have all spoken of her in fond terms. No doubt there were times, as teenagers particularly perhaps, or as toddlers when they didn't quite see it that way, but I think it's an adulthood you recognise what you had in your mother. So, as we've also heard, Betty was a great member and supportive member of this church for a very long time. So I think it's fitting that we're all here, and she would expect it, that we're all here today to say goodbye to her. So we'll just go on with some prayers. God our Father, we thank you that you have made each of us in your own image and given us gifts and talents with which to serve you. We thank you for Betty, the years we shared with her, the good we saw in her, the love we received from her. Now give us strength and courage to leave her in your care, confident in your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, you judge us with infinite mercy and justice and love, everything you have made. We rejoice in your promises of pardon, joy, and peace to all who love you. In your mercy, turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven, through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who died, who rose again, and lives forevermore. Amen. Would you please join with me as we stand and sing our second hymn, The Lord is My Shepherd.
Him now, you believe in him and
are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your soul.
Just like to say to family and friends, we're all sad with losing a loved mother and grandmother and great-grandmother and friend, but we all have the joy of having known Betty, and our memories are obviously quite strong in all of us who knew her. So she lives on us, in us, in our hearts and in our minds and in our memories. So take comfort from that. I'll say another prayer and then I'll ask you to join with me in the Lord's Prayer. God of grace, God of all that lives and dies, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that Jesus has risen from the dead, offering us the hope of new life. Help us to know that because Jesus lives, we shall live also, and that nothing can separate us from your love, which unites us now with Betty, and with all who have gone from us. Amen. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now we're going to stand and have our last hymn, which has meaning to the French family, I understand. On car trips, this was what would be one of the songs that was sung to keep the kids entertained, no doubt, or probably stop them from fighting in the back seat, I would say. So, all things bright and beautiful.
By whose great mercy we have been born anew into a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. God alone is holy and just and good. In that confidence, therefore, we commend Betty to God's judgment and mercy, to God's forgiveness and love. Blessed be God the Father, who has caused the light of Christ to shine upon her. She has gone forth from this world in the love of God the Father, who created her, in the mercy of Jesus Christ, who redeemed her, in the power of the Holy Spirit, who gave her strength throughout her life and at her death. In communion with all the faithful, may she dwell forever in peace. Amen. Since the earthly life of Betty has come to an end, we permit her ashes to be returned to the earth. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The final blessing. To God's gracious mercy and protection we commit you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you now and always. Amen. Thank you. That brings our service for Betty to a close. The family invite you to join with them for something to drink and eat in the foyer afterwards.